Okay. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen wa salatu wa salam ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. I want to thank you guys first and foremost before I begin. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, la yashkurullah man la yashkurun nas. He who does not thank the people has not thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So with that being said, I want to thank you guys for spending time with us this afternoon, this evening. And for those of you who donated, alhamdulillah, we're almost at $4,000. Walillahi alhamd. Our goal between today and tomorrow is $25,000. I know that seems like a lot, but in reality, it's not. we especially African Americans, we have spending power. We don't have saving power. We don't have, you know, we don't have economic intelligence. That's what we are lacking, amongst other things. We are lacking economic intelligence, but our issue is not that we don't have money. That's not our struggle. Our struggle is a lack of pulling our resources together, including our money, and using it in a way that will be beneficial for us, maximizing our wealth, economic intelligence. That is what we are lacking, but it's not that we don't have money. We have money. So when we throw, I want to normalize throwing out numbers like $25,000, $50,000. I want to normalize throwing out numbers like that until it becomes nothing. Until it becomes nothing. I have been at fundraisers in the past where I've had the fundraiser organizer tell me we are trying to collect $250,000 tonight. Tonight. And I'm scratching my head because in the African American community, that is unheard of. That is unheard of. We're not collecting $250. You're lucky if we get $250. You understand? You're good if we get $250 in a night. You know what I mean? And, you know, for him to kind of just throw that number out, he's like, nah, the people here, they have it. Don't worry about it. They got it. I'm like, okay. You know, this is the first time I'm kind of having this experience outside of my own community. And when I saw that that was kind of normal in their community, I'm just like, well, why do we fret and you know, throw a fit when we're talking about raising $10,000? Like $10,000 is nothing. So I want to normalize throwing out numbers like $25,000. I want to normalize throwing out numbers like $50,000, $100,000 in 2 days that we can collect that. I want to normalize that. And not for me to put a number out there like that and for us to be like, you know, women clutching their pearls, men, you know, like, oh, I don't got that. You know, he crazy if he think he gonna raise that. Nah, we got it. We have that. Absolutely. We spend that on a regular. We got $25,000. All of you out there with Balenciaga shoes and Gucci bags and, you know, I mean, I don't mean to put you on the spot like that, but it exists. It exists. We have money. We have spending power. We have spending power, especially African Americans. We have spending power if we don't have anything else. We just lack economic intelligence. So I want to normalize. I want to normalize throwing out numbers like $50,000 in our communities where a person can say, well, we're trying to collect $50,000. And we're like, all right, nobody is making a big deal out of it because it has been normalized. All right. So alhamdulillah, up to right now, we're around $4,000 between 6 o'clock all the way to 10 o'clock. So in a matter of 4 hours, we collected $4,000. That means that we're averaging about $1,000 an hour. We're averaging about $1,000 an hour. And hopefully, inshallah ta'ala, when I wake up tomorrow morning and I take a look at our accounts and I see what we have, that, you know, it has doubled more than that, inshallah. Perhaps some of you guys will go to sleep. You'll wake up in the morning realizing that I can use this money, you know, to, you know, ransom myself from the hellfire. I use this money to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something bigger than the money that I'm giving, which is called tawassul. I keep telling you guys about that. It's not a loss. You can give $1,000, right? Shout out to the sister who gave $1,000. Walillahi alhamd, there was a sister, actually two. Two sisters who donated $1,000 a piece, man. SubhanAllah. And it's such a beautiful thing. Such a beautiful thing. But perhaps you're going to go to sleep. You're going to wake up in the morning for Salatul Fajr. And you're going to look at your bank account and you're going to say, I can spare $1,000. I can spare $500 more. I can spare $250, right? And inshallah, you do that. And then I'll ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you something else in return. So I'm going to pin the Cash App here. Rawdah, Masjid. Okay. Okay, the Cash App is pinned here. And I'll do it here as well. Okay, so alhamdulillah, we had some dynamic speakers. What is that in Hamd? We had Sheikh Tariq Rashid come on and talk about our relationship with the Quran. He mentioned dropped some jewels here and there. I hope that you guys were able to were able to pick up on that. We had Sheikh Hassan, Dr. Hassan Akbar, who came on and dropped some real heavy jewels on us as it relates to our relationship with ourselves. You know, he talked about a lot of things, you know, more importantly, this issue of this incident that happened in Texas, which I was completely oblivious of until he mentioned it. I knew nothing about this situation until he said something about it. And, you know, the connections that he made to that situation, the connections that he made to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's own emotional state was dynamic, was amazing. Okay, so for the next about 45 minutes, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to talk about the third relationship, which is probably the first relationship that we should talk about. And that is our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All right. This is the one consistent relationship in our lives that we cannot do without. This is the number one consistent relationship in our lives that we cannot do without. Our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most important relationship in of all the relationships that we have in our lives, simply because every other relationship that we have in our lives is an extension of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You guys follow me. I try to speak slowly and I try to speak clearly so that you can grasp everything that I'm saying. Every other relationship that we have in our lives is an extension of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How? How is that? Every other relationship that we have in our lives is an extension of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How? Because the relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the foundation of all relationships. And depending on your relationship with God, will pretty much determine your relationship with everyone else in your life. I'll give you a couple of textual evidences that will, you know, point you in that right in that direction. The first is the first hadith that I mentioned just a few minutes ago, where the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, "La yashkurullah min la yashkurun nas." That he who does not thank the people has not thanked Allah. He who has not thanked the people has not thanked Allah, right? So you see the connection between your relationship with people and your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has not thanked Allah who has not thanked the people, right? So you can see the connection here. So if you don't thank people, then obviously you are deficient in your gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are not grateful for the people in your life, then that is an extension of your ingratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because it's really hard to believe that you are super grateful to God, super grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are ungrateful for the people that are in your life. That is something that is inconsistent. Our lives as human beings don't work like that. When you are ungrateful to people, that is just an extension of your ingratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It kind of trickles down. You see how that works? It trickles down. So if you have a hard time being grateful, if people have accused you of being ungrateful, people have accused you at points and times of, in your life of being ungrateful, then there's a strong possibility that that ingratitude that people have accused you of in your relationships with them is a strong possibility that there is some of that extends to your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a strong possibility. The second hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the story of Salman al-Farisi and Abu Darda, right? We're talking about what? We're talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our relationship with God being the foundation of all relationships that we have in our lives. And then our relationship with people is an extension of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Pay attention to this hadith, right? There's a very famous hadith, famous story where Salman al-Farisi, he goes to visit Abu Darda. Their relationship is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a special pact of brotherhood between the Sahaba, especially those who migrated from Mecca to Medina. So he would make a special pact of brotherhood between the Muhajirin and the Ansar. The Muhajirin, those who migrated from Mecca to Medina, and the Ansar, those people who are from Medina. He made a special pact of brotherhood between them, seeing as though the people who migrated from Mecca to Medina did not know the territory. They weren't familiar with the turf. And then many of them, you know, had left everything, had sacrificed everything. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, you and you, your brothers. Sa'd ibn Rabi'a and Abdurrahman ibn Auf, you and you are brothers. And he paired Salman al-Farisi and Abu Darda together as brothers. You and you, your brothers. So Salman goes to visit Abu Darda one day. And Darda comes to the door dressed in shabby clothing. Right? This was before the revelation of the hijab. Right? Before women were obligated to wear hijab and cover themselves. So Salman goes to visit Abu Darda. Knocks on the door. Darda comes to the door. She's dressed shabby, unkempt. And Salman asked her, Ma sha'nuki, why are you dressed like this? And her response was, Akhuka Abu Darda, laysa lahu haja fi dunya, that your brother Abu Darda, he has no concern for the life of this world. He has no concern for the life of this world, right? What was she meant? What she is alluding to is the fact that he's neglecting her. Pay attention. He's neglecting her. He's not spending any time with her. Come to find out, he's fasting all day and he's up at night praying all night, neglecting his wife, right? Pay attention. He's neglecting his wife. But what is he neglecting his wife by doing? He's fasting all day, praying all night. Somebody might say, well, he's justified. There's some men who might do the same thing. They spend all day in the masjid, right? And then they come home and then they want to, you know, they eat with their family and then, you know, they go into their room and they're going to go study. It's like, you've been in the masjid all day long. How much studying are you doing, right? I mean, out of all of this studying, at what point do you share everything that you're studying with your family? Do you just perpetually study? Or at some point, do you take a pause from studying and you spend time with your family so you can disseminate some of that information to the people that you are responsible for teaching? You're going to study all day and all night. You're going to go into your library and you're going to go study all night long. And you've been in the masjid all day long. Like, at what point do you take time out for your family? And in our minds, we might think that we're justified, just as Abu Darda thought that he was justified. At the end of that hadith, Salman had some choice words for Abu Darda. They got up, they prayed at night, and Salman, he turned to Abu Darda and he gave him some jewels. Pay attention to what he said. He said, "Inna li rabbika 'alayka haqqan, wa inna li nafsika 'alayka haqqan." وَإِنَّ لِأَهْلِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقَّ فَأَعْطِي كُلِّ ذِي حَقٍ حَقَّ. He said, indeed, your Lord has a right over you. That's your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ لِرَبِّكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقَّ. That your Lord has a right over you. That's your relationship with God. And this is, and your body has a right over you. This is your relationship with yourself. Something Hassan Akbar alluded to at the beginning, he said, I could talk about our physical relationship with ourselves, eating healthy. And he kind of alluded to that, you know, in bits and pieces during the talk. Your relationship with yourself. He said, your Lord has a right over you. Your body has a right over you. You're fasting all day, praying all night. You're not giving your body time to rest. You're going to burn yourself out. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Inna Allaha la yamil," that Allah will never get tired. He said, "Walakin antum tamillun," but you all will get tired. So pace yourself in your worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you get tired. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not get tired. All right? He said, indeed, your Lord has a right over you, your body has a right over you, and your wife has a right over you. Give everyone that has a right their right. You see the connection here? Your relationship with Allah, your relationship with yourself, and your relationship with others. You can't neglect one or the other. There has to be a balance. You are never justified in giving one more than the other. You are never justified in that. You have to find a balance in that. The Masjid PayPal is Mardiya Community, M-A-R-D-I-Y-A-H, Mardiya Community at Gmail. Okay, so everybody understand the point that I'm getting at. The last hadith is the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ittaqi la haythuma kunt wa atbi'is sayyi'a hasanatan tamhuha wa khaliqin nas bi khuluqin hasan." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Fear Allah wherever you may be." That's your relationship with Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's haqq, his right, is that you fear him and you do not, you know, turn away from him. Fear him, meaning reverence him. When I mean fear Allah, I don't mean be afraid of God, afraid to do something wrong. I'm talking about reverence of God, reverence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you feel embarrassed to do something knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching. Knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears you. You feel embarrassed to allow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbul Alameen, Lord of the worlds, Maliki Yawmiddin, the King of the Day of Judgment, you are embarrassed to allow him to see you out of pocket. That's reverence. So when we use the word fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it doesn't mean like fear, like you're afraid of a dog or you're afraid of a man with a gun. We're talking about reverence of God. The fear of doing something that will have God see you in a light that is displeasing. That's what it means. He said, "Ittaqi la haythuma kunt." Fear Allah wherever you may be, your relationship with Allah. "Wa atbi'is sayyi'a hasanatan tamhuha," and follow up a bad deed with a good deed and it'll wipe it away. You do a bad deed, turn around right behind it and do a good deed. Tamuha, it wipes it away. So if you committed a sin somewhere along the lines today, you can give sadaqah and that'll wipe it away. Give charity, it'll wipe it away. Donate something, it'll wipe it away. Right? One of the sahaba, he was praying in his garden, and while he was making salat, his eyes became fixated on a bird that was flying in and out of the trees, and he lost count as it relates to how many raka'ahs he prayed. After he finished making salat, he felt so horrible that he allowed himself to be distracted while he was talking to God, right? He was talking to Al-Malik. He was talking to the king, and he allowed himself to be distracted by something as insignificant as a bird, and he felt horrible about it. So the garden that he was praying in, he took the whole garden and he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, "That garden, I'm giving it to you sadaqah, for you to give it away or do whatever you want to do with it. And perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive me for being forgetful in my prayer. You understand? Follow up a bad deed with a good deed, it'll wipe it away. Follow up a bad deed with a good deed, it'll wipe it away. That's your relationship with yourself. One of the scholars of the past, he said, I used to have a bad habit backbiting people. He said, so I took an oath that every time I backbit someone, I would give away a dinar, a silver coin, I would give it away sadaqah. He said, فَكُنْتُ أَخْتَابْ وَأَتَصَدَّقْ وَأَخْتَابْ وَأَتَصَدَّقْ. So I used to backbite people and then I would give sadaqah. I would backbite and give sadaqah. You see what I'm talking about? Following up a bad deed with a good deed and then wipe it away. I used to backbite people and I used to give sadaqah. And I would backbite and give sadaqah. He said, فَبِحُبِّي أَدَنَانِيرْ تَرَقْتُ الْغِيبَ. He said, and as a result of my money, I gave up backbiting because I no longer wanted to keep giving away my money. So something had to give. Either I was going to continue backbiting and I was going to end up being broke in this life and in the hereafter, right? In this life and in the hereafter, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Tadruna mal muflis." Do you know who the broke person is on the Day of Judgment? This is the person who comes on the Day of Judgment having fasted, having fought jihad, sought knowledge. He did all these good deeds, fasted, prayed, did all of these good deeds, but you backbit this one, you took the money of this one unjustly, you spilled the blood of this one. So you come on the Day of Judgment and all of the people that you violated, you have to restore. You have to restore the right back people that you took from until you run out of good deeds and then you end up taking their bad deeds. So he said, because of my love for my money, I gave up backbiting. I gave up backbiting. The point that I'm making is to follow up a deed with a good deed and it'll wipe it away. And then his last piece of advice was, وَخَارِكْ النَّاسِ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ, and treat people with good character. These are three relationships mentioned in one hadith. Fear Allah wherever you may be. Reverence Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wherever you may be. Follow up a bad deed with a good deed and wipe it away, and treat people with good character. Those are three relationships mentioned in one hadith. But in all three of the hadith that I mentioned, there is the relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He who does not thank the people has not thanked Allah. Indeed, your Lord has a right over you. Your body has a right over you. Your family has a right over you. Give everybody that has a right their rights. Fear Allah wherever you may be. Follow up a bad deed with a good deed and then wipe it away, and treat people with good character. In all three hadith, and I can keep going on and on and on, but I think you guys get the point. In every single text, there is the relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because that is our foundation. That is our foundation. So what should our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala look like? What should our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala look like? Obviously, there is an ideal relationship with God that we should all be striving towards. And where do we get that from? The relationship of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the most ideal relationship with God that any human being can have. And so therefore, he becomes now uswatun hasana. He becomes now our example. He becomes our example. He becomes our role model. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ uswatun hasana. لِمَن كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَذَكْرُ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. As Allah says in the Quran, you have in the Messenger of Allah uswatun hasana, a beautiful example, an exemplary example, role model to follow, because his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the most ideal relationship that any human being can have with God. So when you're thinking about what is the most ideal relationship that a human being can have with Allah ta'ala, you have in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that example. Now, we are all on different levels as it relates to exemplifying that relationship that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're all on different levels, depending on your level of iman, depending on your enthusiasm, depending on your ambition. There are a number of variables. us, right? There are a number of factors that determine where we fall within the spectrum of that relation, that ideal relationship that the Prophet ﷺ had with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But all throughout the Quran, we can see stories of men and women and the different relationships that they had with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some great and some not so great. Some made mistakes and found their way back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some made mistakes and kept going in their mistakes and never actually made it back to God. You take, for example, the first man that was created, right? We're talking about our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the first man that was created. Another relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is more along the lines of where we were. The Prophet, where we are currently, the Prophet ﷺ here again is the most ideal relationship. But when you look at the relationship between Prophet Adam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first man created, this was the first relationship that man had with God. It's the first actual relationship, which means that it's not the most ideal. Why? Because anytime something is done for the first time, you know, there's going to be some mistakes there. And then by the time you get to the last one, you move further, it evolves, it gets better. So relationship with man has evolved from the time of the relationship between Adam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Adam being the first man created, there has never been before Adam any relationship between any human being and God. This is the first relationship. So while Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is on the further, right? Right, there's a learning curve. Right, exactly, using teacher language. Right, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's relationship with Allah being the most ideal, and then you have at the lower end of that spectrum, the relationship of Adam with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is not the most ideal, but the most practical. The most practical. Most of us, when we look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it looks like almost as if it is untouchable. It is unreachable. Especially when speakers, preachers, Islamic preachers and speakers and scholars, they raise Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to a place where it's like almost unattainable for any one of us as a human being, right? You ever heard a speaker talk about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in such a way where you just feel like he's an angel in human flesh, right? It's unattainable. There's no way that and we even use that as an excuse. We said, well, that was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? This is, what some people do as an excuse to kind of deflect when someone is imposing on them, well, this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. And then we will retort with, well, that was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'm not the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because he's been painted to us in such a way where it's almost unattainable. But then his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not unattainable. It's not unattainable. The relationship that the Sahaba had with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not unattainable. Didn't the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say that there will come a time where people would will convert to Islam and they will have the reward of 50 of the Sahaba. One man from amongst the latter generation will have the reward of 50 of the Sahaba. The Sahaba were confused. They said, oh, Messenger of Allah, you mean 50 of us or 50 of them? He said, no, 50 of you. Khamseen rajulin minkum. 50 of you, the reward of 50 men from one individual from the latter generation of Muslims will have the reward of 50 of the Sahaba. How is that possible? Because they will be working with less resources. They will be working with strictly all we have is the Quran, the interpretation of the Quran from the many different interpretations, right? And then we have the books of Sunnah. We have no practical application. We have no model in front of us to show us how that is done. We just kind of left here to just kind of figure it out. We live in an environment where we are surrounded by debauchery, sacrilegious behavior. And in the midst of all of that, you still have some from amongst us who choose to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's nothing that is more admirable than that. While the Sahaba, they had a safety net. They had the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam around them. Anytime something came up, they could run to him or Messenger of Allah. This happened. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would redirect them. In Ramadan, a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Ya Rasulullah, halaktu. I destroyed myself." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Wa ma ahlakak? What is it that is that serious that has destroyed you?" He said, "Wa qa'atu ala imra'ati fi nahari Ramadan." I had sexual intercourse with my wife during the day in Ramadan. I intentionally broke my fast with my wife during the day in Ramadan. He had a safety net. What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do? He said, "Can you free a slave?" Immediately, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is trying to help him get out of this rut, get out of the situation that he's in. He's seeing that the man is distraught, emotionally distraught. He said, "I destroyed myself." Listen to the language. He's distraught. "I committed a major sin. I intentionally broke my fast during the day in Ramadan with sexual intercourse with my wife." In today's time, you might have a Muslim who's not fasting, intentionally not fasting, and then on top of that, having sexual intercourse with somebody they are not married to. That is a very common scenario in our situation. Very common scenario. You might have a Muslim right now who made an intention to not fast and wake up next to their boyfriend, their girlfriend. So the total opposite of the situation that the Sahabi fell into. He started off the day fasting and then had lack of self-control. He had a lapse in judgment and then had sexual relations with his wife. We're talking about a Muslim who had absolutely no intention on fasting and slept with somebody that's not his wife or not her husband. This is the reality that we live. And that scenario is very common. But where's the safety net for us? We don't have the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to go to. We have scholars that we can rarely get in touch with because they're so untouchable. And even if we manage to get in touch with one of them, we're given some, you know, ready-made fatwa that, you know, required very little energy on his part to try to help us get out of the situation, make toba and, you know, keep it, be patient, you know, all of these ready-made fatwa that are given that shows that the person is not actually in there in the moment with you, no empathy, no understanding. Very generic. Whereas the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the guy came to him and said, "Oh, Messenger of Allah, I destroyed myself," the Prophet laughed. He smiled. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Wa ma ahlakak?" And what is it that is that serious that has destroyed you? What is it that is that serious that you can say that it destroyed you? I'm trying to figure out what's going on. Okay, so for those of you on Instagram, you may have to go over to my Facebook page, right? In a few, my phone is going to die. I have been streaming all day. So there's a strong possibility and probably within the next 20 minutes, my phone is going to die. So you can head over to my Facebook page, Shadid Muhammad/Rawdah Admin, and you can watch it live from there, inshallah. All right, just giving you guys a heads up. probably got about 20 minutes. I probably would be more than about 20 minutes anyway. But just giving you guys a heads up. So the point that I'm making is that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Sahaba had him to go to, you know, to help cushion the blow. The Prophet immediately asked him, you know, can you free a slave? He said, no. He said, well, can you fast 60 days consecutively? Because that's the compensation for breaking your fast intentionally with sexual intercourse. If you break your fast just by eating, then you just make toba and you make the day up after Ramadan. But if you break your fast with sexual relations, the recompense for that, the compensation for that is to fast 60 consecutive days, including the day that you ruined. That's the compensation for that. So the guy says to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I'm an older man. I can't fast 60 consecutive days. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, all right, sit down. We'll find a solution for you. But you see that? The Sahaba had him. In today's time, we don't have anybody. We don't have anybody. And so the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam saying to the Sahaba that there will come a time where a man will embrace Islam and he will have the reward of 50 of you. You understand why now. But it doesn't mean that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's relationship with Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is something that is unattainable. It would require, you know, to the greatest degree of human exertion, but it doesn't mean that it is unattainable. All right. But Adam's relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a little bit more practical for us because it was the first relationship between man and God. So then when you look at Prophet Adam alayhi salam, whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created with his own two hands, right? Bestowed upon him half of the beauty of the world. He taught him the names of everything. وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. Right? Gave Adam all of these things. He told Adam, أُسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةَ. You and your wife live in paradise and eat everything therein with the exception of this tree. All of these blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon him. Similar to us as human beings, all of the blessings that Allah bestowed upon us. Many of us, we have children, healthy. Many of us are healthy. We have a roof over our heads. We have food in our refrigerator. I'm not even talking about the excess. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Man asbaha minkum aminan fi sirbihi." Whoever wakes up from amongst you and is, you know, safe in, you know, in his body, he wakes up, you know, afan fi jasadihi, that, you know, he's secure in his body. Aminan fi sirbihi, his children are safe. وَلَهُ كُوتُ يَوْمِهِ, and he has his, you know, food for the day. فَكَأَنَّمَا حِيزَتْ لَهُ الدُّنْيَا, then it's as if he has been given the whole world. And many of us have those basic things right now. Right now, you are sitting on those basic things right now. Your children are home with you, right, tonight. You know where your children are. If your oldest child is at work, or one of your children are at work, the younger children at home with you, you know where your children are. Your children are within your grasp. Safe. وَلِلَّهِ الْحَمْدُ. You have a roof over your head. Your body, everything is functioning fine. It may not be to the highest capacity, but it works. Your eyes work. You may need a little help with them. Your tongue works. Your ears work. The main faculties that you need, right? They all work. وَلَهُ كُوتُ يَوْمِهِ, and you have your food for today. You have your sustenance for today, don't you? I ain't talking about going shopping for the week. You might not live a week. You got your sustenance for today, don't you? Then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, كَأَنَّمَا حِيزَتْ لَهُ الدُّنْيَا, it's as if you have been given the whole world and everything in it. You have the whole world in your hand right now. Right now. Similar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his relationship with Adam, he gave Adam everything. Taught him the names of everything, created him with his own hands, told him and his wife live in paradise and eat from paradise, you know, whatever you want. Just don't touch this tree. Same thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us everything that the non-Muslims have that is haram. We have in the halal and more. Just a few things in our religion that is haram. And haram for our own good. It's not haram simply because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not like Adam. Allah didn't tell Adam, don't eat from this tree because this tree is dangerous. It's poisonous. The tree was in paradise. For crying out loud. The tree was in Jannah. And he told him, don't eat from a tree that was in Jannah. Not because the tree was harmful. Not because the tree was dangerous. You understand? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes things haram for us in this world, it's to protect us from the harm that's in it. Pork, the harm that is in it. Illegal sexual intercourse, the harm that is in it. All of these things are haram. Alcohol, because of the harm that's in it. Many people suffer from liver poisoning. Many people suffer from so many different diseases as a result of drinking alcohol their entire lives. And we sitting around talking about, well, why is alcohol haram? There's many people who have taken one pull off of a blunt and the chemical in the blunt mixed with the chemical that is already in their body. And there was a chemical imbalance. And as a result of that, they are now mentally retarded. They are now lacking in full use of their mental capacity from one pull off of a blunt. And we still here talking about, well, is marijuana haram? Why is marijuana haram? It grows from the earth. Allah created the earth. Are you serious? But this is, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made these things haram for us to protect us. أَأَنْتُمْ أَعْلَمُ أَمِ اللَّهِ. Do you know better? Or does Allah know better? No, but social media got us, man, all hyped up on ourselves, man, delusional, that we know better than God. Let me know how that worked out for you, man. So Adam, much like us, fell from grace because he ate a tree, succumbing to his own human weakness, as we all have human weaknesses. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him how to repent. Adam didn't know how to repent. There was no concept of repentance before Adam made this mistake, because there was no human sin before this. There was no such thing as a human sin before Adam ate from the tree. So there was no need for a concept of repentance. But when Adam ate from the tree, now that ushered in a different level of the relationship between human beings and their creator. Now there had to be a concept of toba, of repentance. So now that added another layer between the relationship between man and God. So now we know we make a mistake, we repent. You understand? We make a mistake, we repent. That's the blueprint right there. Adam's relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala became the blueprint for man's relationship with God. That we are going to make mistakes. And in the event that we make mistakes, we now know the path back to God, which is through repentance. You understand? Sincere repentance. The same way that Adam did. So when we talk about our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we already have the blueprint, a practical blueprint for how man is to interact with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he says in the Quran, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and Adam learned from his Lord some words. Learned from his Lord some words. Allah doesn't say what the words were, not in that ayat. But then fast forward to the ayat in Surah to A'raf, Surah number 7. This story was in Surah to Baqarah, Surah number 2. Fast forward five surahs later, Surah to A'raf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains what those words were. He mentions the story of Adam again. And then he actually mentions the words that Adam learned from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Does anybody know what those words were? Allah says, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. And Adam learned from his Lord some words. Meaning Allah had to teach Adam how to repent. Because there was no concept of repentance before this, because there was no such thing as a sin before this? What were the words? Anyone know this dua? Anyone know this dua? I'll donate a free t-shirt to the person who can give me this dua. By memory, not that you go Google, memory. Because if you memorize it, then that means that you are in a habit of making this dua. And inshallah, this will be an incentive to continue making this dua. Anybody know the dua that Adam made? Yeah, that was the dua. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ Oh Allah, ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا We have wronged our own souls, meaning him and his wife. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا Oh our Lord, we have wronged our own selves, our own souls. وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا And if you don't forgive us and have mercy upon us, لَنَكُنَّنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ Then we will be from amongst the losers. Pay attention to that dua. Shema, please email me after this is over with. Pay attention to this dua, right? He said, we wronged our own souls. This is, here again, the blueprint of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have wronged our own souls. And if you don't forgive us and have mercy upon us, we will be from amongst the losers. This is what Allah taught Adam. Allah taught Adam how to repent. So now this becomes the blueprint for our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're human beings. We have all of these blessings that Allah has given us. And in spite of all the blessings that Allah has given us, we're still going to err. We're still going to make mistakes. But when we make mistakes, there's always a path back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's our relationship with Allah, in a nutshell. And then, of course, there's the other path, the void, and that is the relationship that Shaitan had with Allah. The relationship that Shaitan had with Allah, that is the path that we want to avoid, which many people are on that path right now. Now let's look and take a look at Shaitan's relationship with Allah. So we know what not to do. We talked about what we should do and how we should engage God. Now let's talk about what we shouldn't do and the path that we should avoid. And that is, you know, the poster child for that particular relationship is none other than Shaitan al-Rajim. How did he go from Iblis, Azazil, Iblis, to Shaitan al-Rajim, the accursed devil? You understand? How did he go from that to that? What happened? How did this preacher, who is not even an angel, but used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amongst the angels, how did he earn that privilege to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amongst the angels? Shaitan was a jinn. Kana min al-jinn. Fafasa. As Allah says very clearly that he was a jinn. How did he get to the status where he's a jinn, but he's worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amongst the malaika, amongst the angels? And then he goes from that status to, you understand? Now, it's not that he disobeyed Allah. He did no different than what Adam did. Allah told Adam, don't eat from this tree. وَلَا تَأْكُلَ مِنْ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ Don't eat from this tree. That was a direct command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Adam, what does he do? He eats from the tree. Shaitan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, with قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسِ And remember when we commanded the angels to prostrate to Adam, and they all prostrated with the exception of Iblis. Here's an act of disobedience. Here's an act of disobedience. But what's the difference between the two? What's the difference between the two? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala approached Adam, he said, didn't I tell you not to eat from this tree? Adam repented. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked Shaytan, ma mana'aka an tasjud lima amartu? قَالَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْ خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طِينٍ. I'm better than him. Allah said, why did you refuse to prostrate to the one that I commanded you to prostrate to? He said, because I'm better than him. You created me from fire, you created him from dirt. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَخْرُجْ مِنْهَا فَإِنَّكَ رَجِيمٌ. Get out of paradise, for you are rajim. You are accursed. Meaning my mercy is removed from you. You will receive none of my mercy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has 100 mercy, is broken into 100 parts. 99 he kept with him. One part of mercy is here on earth. We got to look for it in today's time because it's very scarce. It's scarce. It's a rarity to see mercy, but it exists. It exists. One portion of Allah's mercy he sent down on earth, the other 99 parts he kept with himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You got to search for it. It's here somewhere on earth. You'll see, you know, glances of it. You'll see bits and pieces of it here and there. It's very scarce, sparsely seen, but it exists. And then Shaytan says, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَالَ فَبِمَا أَغْوَيْتَ. Because you put me out of paradise. Puts the blame back on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's God's fault. It's your fault I disobeyed. It's your fault that I did this. Because had you not committed me to prostrate to him, then I wouldn't have been put in the situation to begin with. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound like many of us? If I would have had this, I wouldn't have to steal. If I had money, I wouldn't have to do this. If I had a wife, I wouldn't have to sleep around. If I had a husband, if brothers were this, and what? All of the excuses that we come up with to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Does it sound familiar? Sound like some of the rhetoric that we spew on a regular basis? The excuses that we make to justify our disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't be like Shaytan. Avoid that path. That path got him cursed. Make your mistakes, but always find your way back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Kullu bani Adam khata'un wa khayra khata'ina tawwabun." That all of the children of Adam sin. And the best of the sinners are those who, what? Repent. The best of the sinners are those who repent. He didn't say the best of people are those who don't sin. He said the best of all of the children of Adam sin, the best of the sinners are those who repent. Just be from amongst the best of the sinners. That's all. Be from the best of the sinners. I am just trying to be the best of the sinners. That doesn't put me above anybody. I'm still a sinner amongst the rest of you. I'm just trying to be the best of the sinners in terms of my relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning I sin, I make my mistakes, but I find my way back to God. I do not stay in my path of perdition. I do not stay in my path of sin. I do not stay in my path of disobedience. I do not stay in my path of sin. In rebellion, justifying why I'm doing what I'm doing, you resemble Shaytan. Be mindful. Be mindful of the path that you are taking. Are you taking the path of Adam or are you taking the path of Shaytan? Are you justifying your sins? Are you finding fault with God for your condition because you refuse to do the work that is necessary for you to do to pull yourself out of the situation? If God wouldn't have done this to me, if Allah had just given me this situation, if I had that situation, I wouldn't. Really? So you're going to do what Shaytan did. So, oh, let me get this straight. So if God wouldn't have tested you with this situation, you would be in a better situation. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. So it's God's fault. that you disobey him. It's God's fault you lack discipline. It's God's fault that you lack fear of him. It's God's fault, right? Same thing Shaytan said. Qala fabima aghwaytani, because you put me out of paradise. You did this to me. I was fine worshiping you amongst the angels before you commanded me to prostrate to this creature. Really? Right. Be mindful of the path that you are taking. Are you taking the path of Shaitan? Are you taking the path of Adam? Make your mistakes, but find your way back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make your mistakes and find your way back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not make your mistakes and then stay in that path and then justify. Then justify it. And God forbid you delay your repentance until death is right upon you. God forbid you delay your tawbah until death comes upon you, because in that moment it's too late. This is what is called delayed tawbah. Ta'khir tawbah. Delayed tawbah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in surah number 6, ayah 158, I'm just about done. Turn to surah number 6, ayah 158. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَلْ يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ تَأْتِيَهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَوْ يَأْتِي بَعْضُ آيَاتِ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَ يَأْتِي بَعْضُ آيَاتِ رَبِّكَ لَا يَنْفَعُ نَفْسًا إِيمَانُهَا لَمْ تَكُنْ آمَنَتْ مِنْ قَبْلُ أَوْ كَسَبَتْ فِي إِيمَانِهَا خَيْرًا قُلْ انْتَظِرُوا إِنَّا مُنْتَظِرُونَ. Listen to this ayah, Surah number 6, ayah 158. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, are you waiting? هَلْ يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ تَأْتِيَهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ. Are you waiting for the angels to come to you? He's talking to the person that hasn't repented yet. You're still in the path of sin and disobedience, making excuses for why you continue to be disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why you continue to, you know, disobey Allah. Why you continue to not fast. Why you continue to not pray. Well, you was divorced. Oh, and you was this, and you can't find a wife, and you just came home from prison, and you can't do this, and nobody in the masjid is helping you, and nobody is doing this for you, and nobody opened this door for you, and you can't, you don't, there's no opportunity. So you're just going to just sit in your path of sin and disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you're going to justify that? Then Allah asks, هَلْ يَنْظُرُونَ أَنْ تَأْتِيَهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ. Are you, what are you waiting for? Are you waiting for the angels to come to you? I'm talking to you right now. You listening right now. If you are listening to this right now and you feel like, damn, he's speaking directly to me right now, then you are supposed to be hearing this. On Instagram, I have 20,000 followers on Instagram. There's not 20,000 people here listening. The only people here listening is you. The few 50, 60, 70 people that are listening. On Facebook, I have 74,000 followers on Facebook. It's not 74,000 people listening right now. Only you. Only you. I'm not for 74,000 people. I'm not for 20,000 people. The only reason why you are listening to what I'm saying right now is because this is exactly where Allah wanted you at this time, at this moment, in this space right here. This is where Allah wanted you. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted you to hear. Allah says in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ حَيْثُ يَجْعَلُ رِسَالَتَهُ. Allah knows best where to place his message. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes messages and he places them exactly in front of the people that need to hear it. So if you are listening right now, then it was decreed for you to hear this right now. It wasn't meant for 74,000 people to hear. It wasn't meant for 20,000 people to hear. All of the people that are on Zoom, there were far more people on Zoom before I got on. Hassan Akbar had way more people on Zoom than I have on Zoom right now. The only people that are here are the people that are supposed to be here. And within the people that are here, there's only a few people that are actually listening. So let's take it even a step further. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's message is not for everybody. It's not for everybody. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks a question.
هل ينظرون أن تأتيهم الملائكة? What are you waiting for? You waiting for the angels to come? That's what you're waiting for before you repent? Before you start praying again? Before you start fasting? Some of you sitting here right now, you haven't fasted Ramadan in years. Some of you listening right now, you haven't been praying 5 times a day and God knows how long. What are you waiting for? هل ينظرون أن تأتيهم الملائكة? Are you waiting for the angels to come to you? You're waiting for that moment when the angels come to seize your soul for you to say, okay, all right, I repent. Okay, God, I'm sorry, forgive me. That's what you're waiting for? هل ينظرون أن تأتيهم الملائكة? Are you waiting for the angels to come? أو يأتي بعض آيات ربك? Or are you waiting for some of the signs of your Lord to come to you? يوم يأتي بعض آيات ربك لا ينفع نفس إيمانها. On the day when the signs of your Lord come to you, it will benefit no soul on that day to believe if they didn't believe before. It will benefit no soul to believe in that moment if you didn't believe before. Instagram, I'm going to cut you off because if I don't, then I'm going to lose the recording. So you guys that are on Instagram, you can go over to Facebook Live, inshallah, and you can continue listening via Facebook Live. If I don't cut it off and my phone dies, then we lose the recording, right? You guys follow me. Am I making sense here? He said, on the day when you see my signs or you see the angels coming, that's it. There's no asking for forgiveness at that point. Look at Fir'aun. Fir'aun is a poster child for delayed repentance, right? Fir'aun sees the wave coming upon him and he says, all right, I repent. I believe in Allah. And Allah says, Alan, now you believe? Now you want to believe in me? Don't take the path of Shaitan. Take the path of Adam. So this is our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In ending, I mean, there was so much more that we could have discussed, like the particulars of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Humble yourself before Allah. Humble yourself before Allah. Right? Allah doesn't owe you anything. Humble yourself. Some of us, we feel like we are entitled even with God. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't owe you anything. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when Allah revealed the ayats exonerating her from the lie that was told on her, she said, وَشَّتْنِي فِي نَفْسِي أَهْوَانِ أَنْ يُنَزِّلَ اللَّهُ فِيَّ آيَاتٍ تُتْلَى إِلَى يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ She said, I used to consider myself insignificant. Unworthy of God revealing ayats about me that will be recited into the day of judgment. Who am I? Humble yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Humble, humility in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, Allah doesn't owe you a response. We call on him, but don't say, oh, I made dua, I guess Allah don't want me to have it. No, maybe Allah doesn't want you, maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to call on him more, so he withholds it from you. So that you can call on him more. Allah loves to be called on. Not that, oh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, didn't give me this. Maybe it's not for me. No, maybe it is for you, but maybe you got to work for it. You made dua once, twice, 3 times. The scholars say that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't give you what you ask for, then your relationship with him should be like a child is with his mother. Fak'ud wabki hatta yu'tik Allah. Sit and cry and beg until Allah gives it to you. That's your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your relationship with Allah as it relates to him answering your dua should be like a child with the parent. The child sits and cries. You got a 2-year-old? I got a 2-year-old. I tell him no. He cries for the next 45 minutes nonstop. I promise you. You thinking you're going to ignore him and just turn him, tune him out. He's going to cry for 45 minutes straight until you submit. That's your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm going to cry, I'm going to beg, and I'm going to keep crying and keep begging until you give it to me. That's your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أن الباب إذا تطرق ربما يفتح لك. If you keep knocking on the door, perhaps it will open for you. If you keep knocking on the door, eventually it will open. That's your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter what the odds seem like in the situation, to trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your wali. Allahu waliyu alladhina amanu yukhrijuhum min adh-dhulumati ila an-nur. Allah is the wali. Allah is the guardian. Allah is the guardian of those who believe. He brings them from the darkness into the light. Allah is your wali. Allah is your guardian. And you trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to get you out of any situation that you are in due time. Never lose trust in him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're talking about the creator of the heavens and the earth who has the keys to the unseen, the keys to everything that exists. All opportunities exist in his hand, subhanahu wa ta'ala. How could you ever lose trust in him? Trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has you. No matter what the odds look like in the situation, Allah loves when you trust in him in situations where it's not humanly possible for you to believe that you can get out of that situation. Allah loves that. In that moment, you're like, oh no, God, Allah got me. Please, I have no fear. I have zero fear. Allah loves that, right? When the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was laying under the tree and the hypocrite came and he grabbed the knife off the tree and he put the knife to the neck of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He's in a situation where the knife is pushed up against his neck and he says to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam very arrogantly, "Man ya'asimuka minni ya Muhammad? Who's going to protect you from me now, O Muhammad?" And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam looks at the man with all candor and he says to him, "Allah." Allah. What do you mean? Who's going to protect me? Allah. Even if you managed to kill me, you didn't kill me. Allah gave you permission to do so. So the power is still not yours. It's his. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are you kidding me? I'm not a fan of man. You understand? I'm not a fan of man. I don't give man that type of credit. Even if you manage to kill me, it's because Allah gave you permission to do so. You don't have any power. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. This is our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He looked at the man and he said, Allah, even under those conditions, under those circumstances, how many of us have the power being in situations where the odds are against us? Do we crumble? Wallah al-azim, we crumble. We crumble under that type of pressure. You start having doubt, shaitan slip right in there in that moment because shaitan waits to catch us when we're at our most vulnerable point. He waits to catch us in that vulnerable moment. Every single time he waits right up until the moment where we start to doubt. Well, maybe Allah is not listening to me. Maybe Allah is not responding to me. Maybe Allah is punishing me. Maybe Allah doesn't want good for me. Maybe Allah doesn't even exist, right? See why Allah want me to believe in him and he's still not giving me this and he's not answering my dua. I'm not going to call on him no more. Why I'm going to keep making dua and Allah is not responding. In that moment, shaitan slips right in there. Got you. He waits for the moment when we're vulnerable. Shaitan strikes in our vulnerability. It's a fact. And we know we all have those moments. We all have those moments when we start doubting Allah's power. We start doubting Allah's ability. We start doubting. This slips right in there. But the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, even under those conditions, he looked at the man in his face and he said, Allah. The man was so shaken. His hand started shaking and he dropped the sword because he couldn't imagine that a man would still have that level of conviction even under those circumstances. Where does it come from? True faith. to have that level of conviction, even under those circumstances, even when the odds are against you in that situation, and you still have this unshakable conviction in God. The man starts shaking. He dropped the sword. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam picked the sword up and put the sword to his neck. And he said, "Man ya'simu kamini al-an, who's going to protect you from me now? Because you don't believe in God. So who's going to protect you from me now?" Our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, humble yourself before him. Allah doesn't owe you a response. Call on him. But Allah is, you're not entitled. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't owe you a response. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "I asked permission for two things. Allah granted me permission for one and refused to grant me permission for the other. I asked permission to go visit my mother where my mother was buried, and Allah granted me permission. I asked Allah to forgive my mother, and Allah refused my request." This is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the most ideal relationship between a human being and his creator. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still denied the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this wasn't the only situation. There were other situations. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could tell the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam no, then who are you and I that he can't tell us no? Allah doesn't owe you a response. Allah doesn't owe you anything. You are not entitled to anything from God. To trust him, to call on him, to know that he doesn't owe us anything, to humble ourselves before him, to believe in him regardless of our situation, our circumstance, to put nobody before him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Aisha was exonerated and her mother said, "Kummi ya Aisha ila Rasulillahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam," she said, "Aisha, get up and go thank the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam." Aisha said, "Kalla wallahi la akumu ilayhi abadan, la ashkur illallah." She said, "No, by Allah, I swear by Allah, I don't get up and go thank him. I only thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't put nobody before my Lord. You kidding me? I don't put anybody before my Lord. Kalla wallahi." She said, "Wallahi, I will not get up and go over there and thank him." Thank him for what? La ashkura illallah. I only thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't put nobody before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To obey him, to be sincere to him. Right? And ending and being sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when you are sincere to Allah, he gives you what you want. That's a fact. When you are sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gives you what you want. In the hadith, one of the sahaba, he was sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet was distributing some of the spoils of war, and some of it came to this particular companion. The companion got angry, upset, and he's like, "Why is he giving me this? I didn't follow him for this." And he walks up to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, "What is this, ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah?" He said, "This is, you know, some of the spoils of war that I give to my companions." And he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ma ala hadha tabartu? I didn't follow you for this. I didn't follow you for you to compensate." So the Prophet said, "Well, then why did you follow me?" He said, "Ma tabartuka ala hadha, innama tabartuka li an urmiya hahuna amutu wa adkhul jannah." He said, "I didn't follow you so you could compensate me." He said, "I followed you so I could be shot in my neck with an arrow right here, die and go to Jannah. That's why I followed you." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "In tasduqillah yasduquk." If you are sincere in what you are asking from Allah, Allah will give you what you're asking for. Take that as a qa'idah. Take that as a principle. In tasduqillah yasduquk. If you are sincere with Allah, then Allah will give you what you're asking for. You got to be sincere with him, though. That's the key in our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You got to be sincere with him. In tasduqillah yasduquk. If you are honest, you are sincere with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will grant you what you want. Another battle happened, and there was a body laying on the ground. The sahaba were walking around checking the bodies to make sure everybody was dead. They came across a body that had an arrow sticking out of the neck. And the sahaba says, "Subhanallah, ya Rasulullah, hahuna. Here he is." The Prophet walked over and he said, "Ahua, ahua, is that him? That's the same guy who said the other day he wanted to be shot in his neck with an arrow. And here he is now laying on the ground with an arrow sticking out of his neck, the same spot that he pointed to." And the Prophet said, Saddaq Allah fa saddaqahu. He was honest with Allah, and Allah gave him what he wanted. He was honest with Allah, and Allah gave him what he wanted. Tell me there was a time in your life when you were sincere about something and you approached Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that sincerity and he did not give you what you wanted. Many of us have had what we wanted from Allah many times over, but we don't appreciate his blessings. We abuse the blessing. Some of us are in the blessing right now and you don't even realize it. You are in the very blessing that you asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for, and you so blinded that you didn't even realize it. Allah has answered your dua many times over, but you're still talking about, Allah still didn't hear me, Allah does not answer my dua, maybe it's not for me, maybe it is for you. As a matter of fact, you are sitting in the very blessing that you asked for, but you are so blinded by your situation that you don't even realize that you are sitting in the very same blessing that you asked. Tell me I'm lying. Some of you right now are sitting in the very blessing. You might have been in a marriage and you just asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for reprieve. You just asked Allah to get you out of this situation. But now you're sitting back talking about you single. There's no good brothers out here. There's no good sisters out here. But that's what you asked for. You are sitting in the very blessing that you asked for. No, there might not be any good brothers or good sisters out here in your own mind. But right now, you are sitting in a place of peace. You have a peace of mind different than the situation that you were in 6 months ago, 8 months ago, a year ago, 16 months ago. Are you not? Are you not? Is this not what you asked for? But for us, because we are so greedy, it's never right for us. It's never what we ask for. And you got to be, maybe you need to be more specific in the things that you ask for. The Imam Ahmed, I'll end with this. Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, "Da'awtu Allah and yuhafidhani al-Qur'an. Wa ma hafidhu al-Qur'an wa ana fi sijin. Fa idha da'awtu Allah." He said, I asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow me to memorize the Quran. Oh Allah, let me memorize the Quran. Oh Allah, let me memorize the Quran. Oh Allah, let me memorize your book. He said, and I didn't memorize the Quran except when I was in prison. He said, so when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something, ask him, wa anta fil afiyah, ask him to give it to you while you are in a good situation. Say, oh Allah, give this to me if it's good while I'm in a good situation. You understand? Some of us, we ask for a husband or a wife, but you ask for a husband or a wife while you are in a state of depression, while you're in a state of mental trauma, while you're not in a good place. And while you got that husband, while you got that wife, you weren't in a position to receive the blessing that you asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. You weren't in a position to receive it. So when you got it, you squandered it. When you got it, you squandered it. When you got it, you abused it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you what you asked for many times over. It's just that you weren't in a position to appreciate the blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you. Imam Ahmad said that when you ask Allah for something, ask him to give it to you while you are in afiyah, you are in a good state. Because when you are in a good state and Allah bless you with something, then you're ready to receive it. You're more appreciative of it. You'll handle it with care, right? And very last, be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Fala akunu abdin shakura." Shouldn't I be a grateful servant? Standing up all night praying till his feet would bleed, and then he turns to his wife Aisha and he says, "Fala akunu abdin shakura." To whom much is given, much is required. If you say to yourself, "Allah has blessed me. Allah has given me so much. I have so much to be grateful for." No, you do have so much to be grateful for, and how much of that gratitude have you shown? Gratitude is not shown through, oh, thank you, Allah, alhamdulillah. That's not gratitude. Gratitude is shown, much like any other form of gratitude, is shown through action. Gratitude is a verb, much like love. It's a verb. It shows action. Can't just sit back and say, I'm grateful to Allah for all Allah has blessed me with. But what have you done to show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you're actually grateful for the things that He's given? What have you done? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to stand up all night and pray until his feet would bleed, to show Allah that He's grateful for all of the blessings that He has given. What have we done? Just the ni'mah of Islam, for those of us who are converts to Islam, just the fact that you're here, the fact that you made it to this Ramadan, when we've lost so many in the past year. This time last year, all of the masajid were closed. There was pandemonium, global pandemonium. And more particularly within the Muslim community here in America, trying to figure out where are we going from here. People not going to Jumu'ah, masajid are closed. Imams, you can't even get in touch with them. Nobody knows what to do. You remember this time last year? Pandemonium. And here we are the very next year. Alhamdulillah, most of the masajid are open. Most of the masajid at very least are going to have tarawih. No, we're in a much better situation than we were in. And where's the gratitude? Where's the gratitude? So I leave you guys with that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you. Sorry for going for so long. Just that some messages hit home a little differently, hit a little different than others. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all for your patience. And for your husnul istima'ah, for your good listening. I pray that you guys walked away with something that touched you, walked away with something that, you know, you can take away, that you can begin implementing in your life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all. Please don't forget to donate to Masjid Rawdah. Inshallah ta'ala, tomorrow we will begin at 12. We'll begin at 12, inshallah ta'ala. At 12, we will have Brother Mustafa, who is a PhD student in Umm al-Qura University. And that lecture will only be streamed on Zoom. The brother is very particular. He's not really comfortable with being on major platforms. So for those of you who are part of Masjid al-Rawdah, then you will have a front row seat to that discussion, inshallah ta'ala. After him, we have Mufti Munir, who will speak at 5 p.m., inshallah. So from 12 to 5, there's a gap. And then we'll pick up at 5 with Mufti Munir, and then 6:15 with Sheikh Abu Usama, inshallah. All right, and then we'll close out the program with Abu Usama, inshallah. All right, please don't forget to donate. Please encourage others to donate, inshallah ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from you all. Looking forward to this Ramadan, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to see Ramadan. Allahumma balighna Ramadan. Oh Allah, allow us to witness Ramadan. Allow us to benefit from all of the blessings that the month of Ramadan brings. Brothers and sisters, within the last few days, be mindful of the shayateen. Be mindful of shaitan and his army. They're agitated. They know. Yes, the one at 5 will be live streamed. The others will be live streamed. It's just that the brother, Mustafa, he's not really comfortable being on, you know, major platforms, public platforms. He's studying to finish his PhD. Really just not, some people just don't want to be out there like that, but he did agree to do the talk, inshallah, for those at Masjid al-Rawdah. So we will stream it on Zoom only, inshallah, just for that particular lecture, right? I will be there because I'm very interested in hearing what the brother has to say. And hopefully, inshallah, we'll see more of him as he finishes up his PhD, inshallah. All right. So May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslima kathira. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. In a day or so, just takes me a time to kind of download and re-upload everything. But all of the lectures, that the previous lectures, they will be uploaded to YouTube, my YouTube page, and the audios will also be put on the podcast, the Maradiyya Show podcast, inshallah, on Anchor. Not going to be tonight, maybe not tomorrow, but sometime during the week, inshallah, I will put a post out and let everybody know when the audios and videos have been uploaded, inshallah. Jazakumullahu khairan, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.